So thank you very much for inviting me, Bernard. I have to say that without Bernard, I wouldn't have been able to start my career at Gustave Roussy because he was a believer and he really was extremely helpful in the development of this new concept. And today I will present a story that I just been accepted in Science yesterday. And this story has been developed close to Bernard's department. So I would like to introduce you to a new era of immuno-oncology, which is the anti-cancer probiotics. So 2011 was the turning point because, first of all, a Nobel Prize was awarded to the dendritic cells, which are the very cells that orchestrate the immune system. And secondly, the first immune-targeted antibody, anti-CTLA4 antibody, which was inhibiting one of the most potent inhibitory pathway of lymphocytes, was FDA approved and EMA approved. So it was a turning point in our reasoning also because we no longer consider that cancer should be viewed as a disease of a cell or a genetic or epigenetic disease, but rather conceived as a disease of the host. So there was a paradigm shift in cancer therapy in 2011 in that we no longer consider to manage cancer by just thinking about eradicating the very single stem cell, but rather to boost the immune system to educate a long-lived memory T cell response that will protect against these cancer stem cells. So the way we view that, and it's a very very simple scheme for you to have a view on the cancer immunity cycle, is that the dendritic cell will capture dead bodies, dead cancer cells, and they will migrate to the lymph node. They will educate T lymphocytes that will turn into effector memory T cells producing cytokines, interferon gamma and others, and they will come back to the disease lesion so that these interferon producing T cells will kill the very tumor cell and somehow reprogram the tumor microenvironment. However, this very positive scenario is jeopardized by many mechanisms evoked by cancer cells to evade cancer immunosurveillance. Indeed, less than 70% of human malignancies contain T lymphocytes. And this is because we think that T cells are not primed, not educated at the first place, or T cells are simply excluded from the tumor microenvironment, or T cells are embedded into an inflammatory milieu, which is full of inhibitory receptors, inhibitory signaling pathways. However, we learn from successful clinical trials based on immune-targeted antibodies that T lymphocytes, PD-L1 expression, and the mutational load of cancer are often associated with immune responses. So what comes at the first place to ignite the immune system of a person? So we think that a person, the immune system of a person is controlled or governed by a complex set of factors, the tumor-derived factors, microenvironmental factors, environmental milieu, and this will dictate the threshold, the intensity, the duration of the immunity, which will dictate the efficacy of many treatments, including chemotherapy and immune-targeted antibodies. So today, I would like to invite you to think that the microbiome can actually trigger this cancer immune set point, this immune tone, beyond which an immune response will ensure in patients. So we learn from our textbook that anti-cancer immunity is actually elicited in the tumor-draining lymph node, but there is another place, the gut immune system, so the intestinal barrier, which seems to control at a distant site many inflammatory lesions. So you have to keep in mind that the intestine is actually containing the vast majority of our immune system, in over 200 square meter surface, in very close mutualistic symbiosis with trillions of microbes, bacteria, archaea, phages, parasites, and fungi, and this to ensure very fundamental functions of our body, not only metabolism, but also the maturation of the immune system. So the algorithm is becoming even more complex if you integrate the oncological armamentarium. So therapeutics will destroy or at least affect this very delicate triangle between the microbiome, the intestinal barrier, and the local, the systemic, and the tumor microenvironment and immune system. So these four papers were quite pioneering in that they showed for the first time that if you treat a host with antibiotics or if you use xenobiotic or germ-free animals, you observed readily that the efficacy of many of the anti-cancer treatments, chemotherapy, so cisplatinum, cyclophosphamide, but also adoptive T-cell transfer as presented by Ernest, but also immunomodulators like Toll-like receptor 9 agonist, blockade of IL-10, all of those will be influenced by the gut immune system. In the absence of these bugs that are sitting in our intestines, so more than 2 kilograms of bugs, they control the innate and the cognate immune system in such a way that some of these commensals will be, for whatever mechanisms that we can talk about, either by translocation or by just mobilization of certain components of their walls, they will influence this cancer immune set point and this immune tonus. So we ask a very simple question: could a minimalist microbiome normalize the cancer immune set point of a body? And this would be the very minimum premise for a real synergistic effect between tumor and immune-targeted therapies. And for the first time, we could dream about curing patients. So one of the first demonstrations of this paradigm was brought up by Sophie Vio and Romain Dayer in my lab that showed that a very unknown bug called Enterococcus hirae, who is normally residing in the upper intestinal tract, is actually mobilized during cyclophosphamide therapy. It goes through the jejunum ileum and then arrives very fast in the spleen, escape everything without any septicemia, and educate T lymphocytes to proliferate, to differentiate into interferon gamma producing T cells. And this will in turn modulate the tumor microenvironment and reverse this very, let's say, subtle equilibrium between the good guys and the bad guys, the regulatory T cells and the effector killer T cells in the good direction. So Enterococcus hirae is really capable of boosting the boosting the T effector cells over the Tregs and participate to the cure of these mice that receive only cyclophosphamide. And when you add cyclophosphamide together with the bugs in the context of antibiotics, you restore the efficacy of the drug that were lost with the antibiotic pretreatment. So interestingly, if you go back to patients that receive cyclophosphamide, you suddenly realize that the patients that benefit the most from this therapy are those where you can find in the circulation, in the blood, memory T cell responses against this Enterococcus hirae, while if you look at other memory T cell responses against other bugs, you do not find a positive association. So we were very intrigued by this data, and suddenly, it was a time where everybody, the AACR, the ASCO, was advertising that the very backbone of any cancer treatment modality would be PD-1, PD-L1 blockade, with this burst of FDA approval in many indications of this fabulous immune-targeting antibody. We got our friend Thomas Gajewski demonstrating that the content of the colon for certain species of bifidobacteria, so namely the longum and the brevet, where this content was actually responsible, well, at least highly associated with the dendritic cell activation profile, as well as which paves the way for the CTL, so cytotoxic T lymphocyte proliferation and activation in the lymph node. And so, in other words, the more you get these bifidobacteria in the colon of the mice, the better the mice are respond to this immunotherapy or at least have a natural immunosurveillance against their cancer. So we wanted to revisit this notion. So my very talented postdocs, Bertrand Routy and Lisa De Rosa, Lisa was actually trained in Bernard department for a couple of years. They had the idea to go back into the files, the patient's files, and try to analyze in Bernard's patients and also Benjamin Best's non-small cell lung cancer patients, whether the intake, the uptake of antibiotics, so ampicillin, tetracyclines, macrolides or fluoroquinolones could actually reduce the time to progression or the overall survival of patients that were receiving in the FDA-approved indication, so for advanced stage 4 non-small cell lung cancer or kidney cancer or bladder cancer, were receiving these anti-PD-1, PD-L1 inhibitors, well, antibodies. And so on 175 patients, they could first of all make the observation that one third of our patients are actually receiving these antibiotics at least 1 month prior to the therapy. And you can observe and appreciate how markedly it inhibits the benefit expected from this therapy. And this was independent from all the other clinically relevant parameters, and it was overruling the effect of proton pump inhibitors or even steroids. And interestingly, it was corroborated in a larger series of patients by Americans and other colleagues from Dijon. So, as you can imagine, the antibiotics are actually killing the gut microflora as a first step, and so we turn to experts in metagenomics analysis, those people that set up these quantitative methods of analyzing the 20 million reads that can define our 1,000 species of bacteria and archaea, and they ended up making the demonstration, so in two independent cohorts of patients and in the 2 to 3 independent series also of patients, taking into account the antibiotic uptake, and I show you the data at diagnosis, they were able to show that Akkermansia muciniphila, which is a bacteria quite known from the cardiometabolic centralized experts for its capacity to reduce the metabolic disorder, to struggle against obesity, and to be associated also with health and higher permeability of the intestinal barrier. So this bug was standing out as the one contrasting the best, the responders from the non-responders, whether we would look at the best clinical outcome or the absence of progression at 3 months of the administration of therapy. And so this Akkermansia muciniphila is accompanied often by friends that are called alistipes and also ruminococaceae. And it was interesting to see that in other cohorts from our best collaborators, these bugs, the same kind of bugs or associations were found. And so you can appreciate that, for instance, the partial responders have a high propensity to house this Akkermansia muciniphila, while the progressive diseases have less propensity to do so. And interestingly enough, if you want to make a link between the gut and the tumor immunosurveillance, at some point you have to stop by the blood because cells have to traffic back and forth. And so we were interested in looking at the memory T cell response of individuals that are receiving this therapy at the level of their memory T cell response against a list of commensals that you can see on the right-hand side here. And you can appreciate here that on this heat map that the only real relevancy of developing memory TH1 immunity against the commensals are ascribed to this Akkermansia muciniphila or even Enterococcus cirrhea. I will come back to this later. And you see how far it is in that, how protective it is that the one individual that can really mount a memory T cell response against the Akkermansia have a better overall survival, whether we look at CD4s or CD8s, and these responses are blocked by anti-class 1 and class 2 antibodies, so they are not just adjuvant effects, but cognate responses. So to show a cause-effect relationship between the fact that you could get a dysbiosis, so a deregulated repertoire of the gut microbiome and the resistance to therapy, one of the ways you can show that its link is just by infusing or performing an oral gavage of germ-free animals or antibiotic-treated animals with the stools of patients. You wait for this human microbiome to reside or to colonize at some point, and then you inoculate the cancer and treat the cancer with a specific therapy, and you just monitor whether these curves, these natural curves, are hampered by the treatment or anti-PD-1 antibody, yes or no, depending on the stool that you have infused at the first place as an oral gavage to these poor mice. So Bertrand and Lisa ran this experiment in 5 non-responders and 5 responders, but they were in a blinded fashion because we didn't have the clinical outcome at that time when we handled the feces of these patients. And I am showing you a typical example of a progressor and a responder. So if you can appreciate here that the transfer of a non-responding the feces of a non-responding patients are conveying complete resistance, while the stools of a responder is actually transferring somehow a significant anti-cancer immune response. And the pool data of 5 individuals in each group is actually demonstrating that there is a significant difference, meaning that the fecal composition is actually dictating the success of the most important immunotherapy in the world currently. So the other way to show a cause-effect relationship between dysbiosis and sensitivity or resistance to therapy is just to bring up the most important bug that seems to be immunoregulatory or immunostimulatory. And so we selected Akkermansia muciniphila because you understood that it was the best one in the composition of the metagenomics composition, and IRE because I told you in introduction that it was stimulating a Th1 immunity. And also we knew that these two bugs could get together and be friends because they were actually regulating the goblet and the mucin production, the antimicrobial peptide released by the Paneth cells, and also modulating the tight junctions as shown by others. Interestingly enough, Enterococcus aureus is easy to cultivate and can be extremely often cultivated from the feces of the responding patients. So we, Mariam Tidjani Alou in our lab, coming from Didi Raoult, one of the best cultivator of mondial feces in the world, he transferred his method to our lab, and she was able to actually align and isolate and describe new species in cancer patients. But interestingly enough, Enterococcus aureus stood as one of the best in predicting somehow the propensity of a given patient to respond to PD-1 blockade. And you see that these patients that can mount a memory Th1 immunity against this Enterococcus aureus that is in the feces of the same patient are actually the ones that are protected and benefit the most from this treatment. So Enterococcus aureus and Akkermansia muciniphila were our favorite bugs that we decided to transfer by oral gavage into animals that were bearing outward dysbiosis. So we created this outward dysbiosis by just treating the mice with broad-spectrum antibiotics. So in this case, these mice failed to respond to anti-PD-1 antibodies, as you can see, as opposed to the control without antibiotics that do respond. And so you transform these mice totally resistant to PD-1 blockade into responders as soon as you transfer by oral gavage this Akkermansia alone or the combo of Akkermansia plus Enterococcus aureus. You see that the growth kinetics are really hampered at the same level as the one of the positive control. But we are in an ecosystem, and if you mess around with the partners of Akkermansia, if you select, for instance, a bacterium tenu, you end up with a tumor flare-up. So it's not as easy as it appears, But we could reproduce the good partnership between Akkermansia and Enterococcus cirrhae in this feces of patients that were dysbiotic. So the second way to induce an overt dysbiosis is to enforce the by oral gavage, the disequilibrium of the flora, if I can say so, by just transferring the bad feces, so feces of patients that have either received antibiotics or was simply by metagenomic diagnosed as these balanced patients at the level of the microbiome. And so if you do so, the patients, the mice, the poor mice, which is a recipient of this bad stool, is actually resistant, but yet would respond to the combo of Akkermansia and Enterococcus cirrhae. And this has been reproduced in several cases of dysbiotic feces, as you can see. And Akkermansia alone, Enterococcus cirrhae alone, or both together, and even Somalistipes, are actually capable of restoring the lack of responsiveness that was programmed in these recipients. And Lisa De Rosa was also able to reproduce this data that were obtained against the sarcoma in an orthotopic renal cell carcinoma in BALBC mice. And in this particular model that you can follow by luciferase with these images, you see that the combo of CTLA-4 and PD-1 co-blockade seems to be the best. However, if you transfer a bad feces, this combo fails to work unless you can come back with Akkermansia, and this will restore the responsiveness. So how can it work? So I am not going to deep into the details of this story, but just sufficient to say that in the mesenteric lymph nodes, so the part that is draining the upper intestinal tract, when you perform this oral gavage or when you perform this therapy, what happens is that there is a tendency of these bugs to elicit an immune response in the draining lymph node. And these lymphocytes that have been educated start expressing very interesting chemokine receptor that play the role of attracting them to places where the ligand of this chemokine receptor is accumulating. And as a matter of fact, the ligands for CCR9 accumulates in the tumor microenvironment. And so supposedly, the T cells that we elicit in the gut are actually trafficking back to the lesions because there is a competition, a gradient of chemokine that that is much higher or much stronger towards the lesion than the gut, so that the T cells specific of the commensals will prefer to home to the lesions rather than to traffic back to the intestine. And so from a tumor which is devoid of T cell infiltration, you end up with a tumor which is higher, which has a higher density in effector T cells. And so the ratio between the good guys and the bad guys T cells is markedly increased when Akkermansia is given to these dysbiotic animals. And so interestingly also, we could find a granuloma accumulating in the microenvironment of the tumor as if there would be some battle there and some rearrangement of reprogrammation of the tumor microenvironment through these bugs that we are putting in the gut. So concretely, for immunologists, the cancer immunosurveillance is dictated by interferon gamma, which is a potent anti-angiogenic factor. And interferon gamma is actually downstream of IL-12, which is a pivotal regulatory cytokine, which push the T cells to be polarized towards the right direction, so against the cancer and for the host. And luckily enough, we were able to show that Akkermansia and Enterococcus cirrhae are actually very good bugs to influence the dendritic cells to produce this pivotal cytokine IL-12. And you see that if you neutralize IL-12 in the setting of PD-1 blockade or in the setting of Akkermansia mucinophila, you just simply blunt the efficacy of the treatment, meaning that with our bugs, actually, that we enforce by oral gavage, we just recapitulate what we would obtain with the regular treatment, the regular blockade of PD-1. So in other words, IL-12 is one of the major regulatory cytokines that account for the success of PD-1 blockade and the success of these oncobacs that we are now using to feed our dysbiotic mice. So in other words, will anti-cancer probiotics normalize the cancer immune set point? we have a tendency to believe that we might get to the point of re-establishing the immune tonus of a person, so setting up, resetting the stage of rendering the target, if I can say so, the patient fit, immunologically fit, to be able to respond to any kind of immunomodulation, either an immunogenic chemotherapy or an immunomodulator. And so we believe that the future of oncology will reside in first be able to diagnose a dysbiosis, an intestinal dysbiosis. These might rely on metagenomics, metatranscriptomics, tulturomics, or PCR analysis, or other analyses that we might be able to find, as well as be able to come up with complementary treatments that will somehow, at least for duration of the treatment, be able to compensate for the lack of very immunogenic bacteria or bacteria that bring up some systemic fitness to these patients. So diagnosis, therapy, and chemo prevention might be the future of the exploitation or the harnessing of the gut microbiome against cancer. And I would like to finish by also acknowledging our colleague from the MD Anderson, who actually made the same discoveries as the one that I presented today. Jenny Vargo has worked on melanoma, and she extended our data achieved in non-small cell lung cancer and kidney cancer and bladder cancer. She showed that the composition of the mouse is actually the bacterial composition of the mouse is not as important as the one from the intestine, because only the fecal composition will impact, so the high diversity of the bugs will be welcome to respond to therapy, to PD-1 blockade in melanoma. And so the tight equilibrium between a number of firmicutes, so namely the Fecalibacterium content is very important, will dictate the enrichment in T lymphocyte into this melanoma and will set the stage for the responsiveness to PD-1 blockade. So Deepak Gabbalakrishnan is the first author of her paper that will be in back-to-back in Science with ours. So I would like, of course, to finish this story by deeply acknowledging my team and they work day and night. So Bertrand Routy, Lisa De Rosa, Connie Duong, Mariam Tijani-Alou, Meriem Messaouden, and all the others. I will not quote everybody, but these team players also, the clinicians of several institutes in Paris, and Bernard, of course, that I already, and Laurence Albiges, they were key in this success. And I would like also to acknowledge our colleagues from the INRA for the metagenomics analysis, and Guido and Didier Raoult for their support in different directions. Thank you very much. I take your questions now.